Hi guys, and welcome back to another IBRACORP video. I'd like to take this moment just to thank each and every one of you for clicking on the video, for liking the video, for subscribing to our channel. Seriously guys, every subscription just helps the channel grow and helps me give back to you. So a big thank you to everyone who subscribes to the channel. That's really appreciated, as well as everyone who signs up to the website. In today's video, we're going to jump straight into your Docker tips and tricks. Some of these are old, some of them I'm hoping are new. There's people that are still sort of asking me some of this stuff as recently as today. So I thought this would be a great opportunity to just put them all into one video. So let's see what you think. If you think it was useful, if you think it could be improved, just drop it down in the comments, let other people know. These are some of the things I think are pretty helpful to people, either the beginners or they just aren't aware of these features. As usual, our motto is, let's get stuck into it. All right, so we're in our Unraid server. As you can see, we're running version 6.9.1, which I've already covered upgrading to 6.9.1, and it's looking pretty good. All right, everything's set up. We've got our containers running. We've got all of these containers that we've also done videos on how to set them up. So they're all running perfectly fine. We're pretty happy. No worries. We're not going to worry about that stuff too much today in terms of getting an app running. We've done that plenty of times. Today, I'm just going to cut to a couple of these tips. Let's start with the first one. In Unraid, if you are in the Docker tab, which we are here, as you can see, and you select the basic view to advanced view in the top right, it's going to give you a couple more options here. For a start, you start getting a lot more information that you can't see in the basic view. If I just switch around, you can see pretty nice and clean. Click it again. We start getting all sorts of other information here. We've got the IDs, who the repository owner is, and a couple of extra details. The first tip I've got for you is auto start and auto stop. All right, seems pretty straightforward. If you just toggle the option here, you'll be able to auto start those containers if your server was to restart or Docker was to restart. What you may or may not know is once you hit the auto start, it allows you to have a wait option. See right here, which is in seconds. What that means is if I was to put 10 seconds in this one, this would start up instantly. It would then start this one instantly. But once this one starts, it will wait 10 seconds before it executes the next one. Just a handy tip there. You can use it to stagger out your server startup. Pretty helpful if you've got containers that take a little bit to start up and they might have dependencies, which takes us on to our next tip. The next tip with Unraid and Docker is that the order that the containers start is actually top to bottom. This is one I get asked frequently, and I'll explain. Anytime you have something set up with a database, for example, we've got MariaDB here, you usually want the database to start up first. The reason is a lot of things depend on the data in the database. So what we'll do is move the database higher up in this list using the arrow option on the right hand side. Same with Redis, that's also a transactional database. So that way we can make sure that these two run first and Unraid will start them first in the order from top to bottom. The next tip I've got for you is custom Docker networks. Now, if you look at the network here, this is one I get asked about a fair bit. You'll notice that I have my own custom network here. It's been covered plenty before, but people still ask, so I thought I'd throw it in here. So if you don't know how to create a Docker custom network, it's as simple as this. In your Unraid screen, just open up the terminal, which you'll find in the top bar. I'll move that over here. So here's our terminal. In the terminal, type in Docker network create and the name of the network you want to give it. Call it IBRA test. All right, pretty simple, straightforward. Hit enter. There you go. That's just created a custom Docker network. So we'll close this and we'll refresh. Just to make sure we've got that. We'll go into a container. And in the container screen, under network type, is our custom network, IBRA test. Now, some of you might be asking, what's the benefits of a custom Docker network? The first benefit is that the containers are all talking to each other on the same IP address subnet. The other thing is, it allows you to set a specific IP address for that network. Now, if you switch it to bridge, you don't have that option, neither in host. So allowing you to have a custom network means you can have a fixed IP address for that particular Docker container. Another benefit that you may not know is when you have them on the same Docker network, you can allow them to call each other by their container name rather than an IP address or port number. And this is pretty useful if you're using something like Nginx, for example, whether it's Swag or Nginx Proxy Manager. If it's trying to call to another container, Having them on the same network means they can use each other's names. So I can just type in Nginx Proxy Manager rather than 192.168, etc., etc. So that's another handy feature there. So we'll move on to the next one. In the Docker containers, if you would just open one up, and we've got the advanced view ticked up here, as you can see. We'll just tick advanced again. Scroll down and you'll see these fields, extra parameters and post arguments. Extra parameters will allow you to actually link to other containers. Sometimes you might be following documentation of a container and it might say you need to put in something like this, for example, --MariaDB. In those cases, especially if it's something like Docker Compose, it might be just trying to refer to the link to another database. So that's where you would enter that information. The next one, while we're on this screen, is mapping parameters. So if you're looking at a Docker run command, and I'll just try to bring one up for us. So here we are on PostgreSQL on Docker Hub, and you can see that it's got a Docker run command. Now what you're looking at here are environment variables. So this environment variable, for example, Postgres_password, will allow you to put a secret password and map that on startup. And you'll find on Docker Hub or a lot of these Docker containers, they actually have a lot of variables that you can map yourself. And these will allow you to map them on startup and avoid having to do them in the actual user interface of that application. So that every time you start the container, that information is mapped on startup and is persistent across restarts. So in order to do that, you can see Postgres_password. We copy that. Now I understand this is not a Postgres container, guys, so bear with me, okay? I'm just doing it for example's sake. You can just go add another half port variable, etc., etc. And under here, you would go to variable. Under the name, just give it a name. So we know it's a password field. You might want to just give it password. The key is the actual parameter or the variable name. So this one here. And you can see it's signified by this hyphen E. We go back, put the key there. That's done. Okay, you don't need to put a semicolon or anything like that, just the key. Then the value is the actual password in this case, so whatever it is you want to put. You can then customize the default value if you were creating a template. I have a separate video on creating templates if you wanted to get a template onto the App Store and whether you want to mask it. So for a password, you probably want to mask it, for example. We click add. There it is there. All right, now you can't just do this with any container. You need to go to the container on Docker Hub and make sure that those variables actually exist. You know, have a read of their documentation. It will tell you if they have variables that can be passed through. So just like here, environment variables, perfect example. So you've got this option. You can put the user if you like. You know, you want to put all this other stuff. You can do that on startup anytime you want. And you can do that on any container, even if it's from the community app store. On to the next one, CPU pinning. Now, if we just click advanced view again, if we come down under here, you'll see CPU pinning. You see on this server, we've got 4 CPU cores that we can pin. And if you check them, you can allow the server to manage it a little bit tighter and say that, okay, I only want this container to use 1 CPU. That's it. That's all I want it to do. And if it, you know, stretches that 1 CPU out, it's not going to stretch out our whole server. Another important one, guys, I noticed that when people report issues on, for example, the Unraid forums or my container for Ophelia, quite often they're not providing the logs. So for KSHET URL monitor here, for example, we'll just left click and click logs. You see this one hasn't been starting, so it's actually been quite faulty. And if I scroll up, you can start having a read and see what the issues might be. Now, if you're not an expert in development, you know, maybe the messages you're seeing aren't very clear. Sometimes they'll just tell you what the problem is in clear English. In other cases, it might give you a bunch of stuff that really makes no sense. In either case, this is the information that you need to share with the community when you're asking for help. So the logs are very important. It also allows you to see what the container is doing right from the minute you start it up. Now, the last thing I'll probably tell you about, because that really covers, I think, most of the stuff that a lot of people might want to know with containers, updating and backing them up. It's essential that you're doing that if you are looking at updating your containers. If you're using the auto update plugin and the app data backup plugins, which I covered in the last top 20 plugins video, sometimes there are containers that you don't want to automatically update, or you want to have a little bit more control of when they're updated. I'll show you what you can do about that. You click advanced on the container, it'll actually give you the link directly to Docker Hub. So we'll go to that. So here we are on the Docker Hub for Nginx Proxy Manager. And if I just go to tags, here's the list of tags that are currently listed and the different versions that are available. So every time a version comes out, it'll come with a version number. or you'll have the latest. Sometimes there are multiple tags with the same version number, but they are different architectures. So also something to make sure you read. So let's say, for example, I only wanted to keep version 1.14. I didn't want it to upgrade past this version until I'm ready to upgrade it. The by default, most containers just have latest in there, or they might not have anything, which will always pull the latest image. If you wanted to set it to a specific version, back in the container screen here under advanced view, you see you've got the repository line. So on the repository line, as you can see, it's just got the name. That is basically going to be pulling the latest all the time. But if I wanted a specific version, you put in two dots just like that and paste the version number that we just saw as it's listed here, because this is actually how it's written. So this is the version that we want. So version 1.14, for example. So then come down, click apply, wait for that to run. It will go and pull that version down and click done. Nginx Proxy Manager is now running, and it's running on that version that we asked it to, 1.14. So that's how you set a specific version. The other alternative, of course, if you don't want to do it that way, is through the auto update application plugin. Instead of having automatically update all of them, we'll go to Docker here, click no, and then you can just check off the ones you don't want to update. So that's pretty much it, guys. I hope that covers some important parts of Docker on Unraid and some container information for you. If you found it helpful, please consider subscribing, give us a like on the video, a big thumbs up, chuck a comment down below on what you think are the most useful tips for a beginner or advanced user when it comes to Docker. We'd really love to see your feedback. Thank you again for watching an IBRACORP video, and we'll see you in the next one. Cheers.